Well, a very good morning to you all once again. It's good to be able to meet like this over the internet today. And we're very grateful for the people who make it possible each week, by which I mean Colin, James and Steve, not Bill Gates. As we present these services each week, we have no idea exactly who joins us, nor from where they might be watching. So if you're a visitor to this service today, we hope very much that you find it helpful. But this week we do know we have some visitors from the city joining us, as this is the week when we have our annual civic service. So there are various people from our city and district councils with us, including the Mayor, Councillor Mrs. Debbie Baker, and her husband Steve, the Deputy Mayor, Councillor Rod Yardley, and the Sheriff, Dr. Darrell Brown. The more attentive of you will have noticed that they're all the same as last year, as there was no change of mayor in 2020 due to the pandemic. But we do wish you and all the other civic visitors a very warm welcome this morning. We've got the usual mixture of music and readings and prayers today, with various people taking part from their different locations around the city. And to get us started, it's great to have the winner of last week's St. Joseph's Primary School Head Teachers Award for the Best Online Pupil, Theo Charters, who with the help of his sister Primrose is waiting over on Bowley Park to read some words from Psalm 147 for us. So over to you, Theo and Primrose.
Praise the Lord. It is good to sing praises to our God. It is good and pleasant to praise him. God heals the brokenhearted. He bandages their wounds. He counts the stars and names each one. Our Lord is great and very powerful. There is no limit to what he knows. Sing praises to the Lord. Praise our God with music and songs. Praise the Lord.
Well, thank you very much, Theo and Primrose. That was really great. Thank you. So with those words of praise from 3,000 years ago in our minds, we use some great words from about 150 years ago now as we sing Crown Him with Many Crowns. And this week, we're led in our music from their studio in Brownsfield Road by Colin, Sophia and Annabel Bridle. Join in with us with the words that are on the screen if you'd like to, or just sit and listen and praise God in your hearts. Crown him with many crowns.
Christ, soul, and sing.
Well, thank you very much indeed for that music. That note of praise and thanks continues now as we just take a moment to see what folk from the congregation have been up to this week as they found ever more creative ways of experiencing lockdown. Thank you very much for those messages and clips, everyone. Please feel free to send in anything that you'd like included each week and remind us too of any birthdays and celebrations that might be coming up. It helps to encourage people, to cheer them up when they see things like that. So with those things in mind and any other things that we're grateful for, we're going to offer our praise to God now as I lead us in prayer. And then we can all join in wherever we are this morning with the words of the Lord's Prayer. Let's pray. Loving God, we're here today to bring you our worship and express our praise. Thank you for all that you are to us, sustaining us and providing for all our needs, watching over us and protecting us in every situation, encouraging us and giving us hope when life is difficult. Thank you for the particular benefits which we enjoy here in this place, for the history and traditions of this city, for its peace and beauty, for the sense of community that we experience, and for all those who work to ensure that things function as they should, for schools and colleges, for shops and businesses, health centres and our hospital, police, firefighters and the emergency services, elected councillors and council employees, churches and chapels, music and the arts, friends and neighbours. We're grateful, Lord, and we pray that you'll help us not to take any of it for granted. As we worship you this morning, scattered around this city and area, but united in your love, may we each know something of your presence with us, and may that make a positive difference to us as we face another week. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And join in with me the words of the Lord's Prayer, which will be on the screen if you'd like to. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Now let's sing once again as Colin, Sophia, and Annabelle lead us in a couple of contemporary songs, giving us the opportunity to draw closer to God and to offer ourselves in service to him.
I will seek you. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, when my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, to be overcome by your presence, Lord.
Now, as we said earlier, it's good to be joined by some of our civic representatives today, and we're delighted that our Mayor, Councillor Mrs. Debbie Baker, is going to read for us now some words from the second chapter of Paul's letter to the Colossians. Over to you, Madam Mayor.
A reading from Paul's letter to the Colossians, chapter 2. So then, just as you received Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live your lives in him, rooted and built up in him, strengthened in the faith as you were taught, and overflowing with thankfulness. See to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends on human tradition and the elemental spiritual forces of this world, rather than on Christ. For in Christ, all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form, and in Christ you have been brought to fullness. He is the head over every power and authority. You were buried with Christ in baptism, in which you were also raised with him through your faith in the working of God, who raised him from the dead. When you were dead in your sins, God made you alive with Christ. He forgave us all our sins, having cancelled the charge of our legal indebtedness, which stood against us and condemned us. He has taken it away, nailing it to the cross. And, having disarmed the powers and authorities, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. Thanks be to God.
Well, thank you very much indeed for that. Before we reflect on what Paul has to say in those words and what they might have to say to us today, let's pray. Loving God, open our ears to hear your words. Open our eyes to see your ways, and open our hearts and minds to know how to respond. In Jesus' name, Amen. Well, today we're continuing our little exploration of Paul's letter to the recently established Christian community in Colossae. Colossae was a cosmopolitan town in what's now Turkey. And Paul's friend Epaphras set up the church there. And Paul is now writing to these people from Ephesus, where he's under house arrest for his preaching activities. He's particularly concerned that these new believers should ensure that they keep Jesus at the heart of all that they believe and all that they do. The world of Paul's day was, of course, very different from ours in some ways. but it's also very similar to ours in many ways, not least in the proliferation of different philosophies and belief systems. All kinds of ideas were circulating, some of which seemed on the surface to have a lot in common with Christianity, but all of which had the potential to derail those who had committed themselves to following Jesus and his ways. If you read the account of Paul's visit to Athens in Acts chapter 17, you'll see he'd come up against this when he spoke to the philosophers at the Areopagus, people who Luke tells us spent their time doing nothing but talking about and listening to the latest ideas. A bit like listeners to Radio 4 or readers of The Guardian, really. As we've already seen in this letter, having introduced himself, expressed his thanks for the Colossians' faith, and established the focus of the letter on Jesus Christ, Paul has set out a little bit about his own calling and his ministry, the goal of which, he tells us, is to help the Colossians grow and develop in their newfound faith, and to be encouraged in heart and united in faith. And he goes on now to expand on that, to advise them about how to keep Jesus at the heart of all they believe and all they do, as we at Wade Street Church now in the 21st century try to do, as we say we're a church at the heart of the city with Christ at the heart of the church. And he reminds them here that they've been rooted in Christ. That's the foundation of their faith. And in his Greek here, he uses what we call the perfect tense to express the idea that this has happened. It's a once and for all experience. They have been rooted in Christ. The foundation has been laid through the preaching of Epaphras. And that's the core of everything else. But now, in one of Paul's frequent mixed metaphors, they need to build on those roots. They're to be built up in Christ and strengthened in their faith. And both of those verbs are in the present tense. So this is something that's to be ongoing, something you need to keep working at. And it is, as Paul stresses again and again in his letters, to be done in the context of thankfulness to God, overflowing with thankfulness, he says. It's thanking God for who he is and for what he has done that gives us the confidence to keep on going, that gives us the expectation of even greater things to look forward to. But, says Paul, if all that's going to happen, they need to guard against being led astray by the seemingly plausible but ultimately misleading teachings of those who are peddling a false gospel. As we've already noted, looking at this letter, there were various people who were pushing their own brand of religion in Colossae for all sorts of different reasons. There were some Jewish believers who were still insisting on such ritual observances as circumcision and keeping various festivals as necessary if they were going to be put right with God. Other philosophers were teaching an early form of what we now call Gnosticism, whereby it was the acquisition of secret knowledge and esoteric wisdom that was the key to salvation. And there were yet others who were still very much attached to their pagan ways, to the old gods and goddesses of the Greek pantheon, which they tried to incorporate into their new faith in Jesus. And none of these will work, says Paul. All you need to focus on is Jesus. As ever, Eugene Peterson's paraphrase of these verses in The Message drives the point home. Let me just read to you verses 8 to 10 in that version. He says, "Watch out for people who try to dazzle you with big words and intellectual double talk. They want to drag you off into endless arguments that never amount to anything. They spread their ideas through the empty traditions of human beings and the empty superstitions of spirit beings. But that's not the way of Christ. Everything of God gets expressed in him, so you can see and hear him clearly. You don't need a telescope, a microscope, or a horoscope to realize the fullness of Christ and the emptiness of the universe without him. When you come to him, that fullness comes together for you too. His power extends over everything." And these empty and deceptive philosophies, as Paul describes them, are teachings that do not fit in with the gospel of grace that he's preaching. See, Paul's not against philosophy per se. After all, he's always encouraging people to think about what they believe, to weigh up his words, to reflect carefully on the ways in which faith in Jesus affects attitudes and worldviews. Paul is not, as some people would seek to portray him, anti-intellectual, advocating a blind and unthinking devotion to God that somehow bypasses the brain. A little while ago, a French friend of mine posted on his Facebook page a cartoon from the infamous Charlie Hebdo magazine, the punchline of which was three religious people saying, "Oh no, we can't think for ourselves." I didn't respond on Facebook, but it did occur to me that my friend must be very ignorant of such people as Rabelais and Racine and Pascal and Mauriac and Gide and Ellul and a whole long list of other French thinkers who made no secret of their Christian faith. Just as we, this side of the channel and beyond, have Milton and John Donne, C.S. Lewis, T.S. Eliot, Tolkien, Stanley Spencer, the artist Bono, Francis Collins, director of the Human Genome Project, John Polkinghorne, professor of maths at Oxford University, and many, many others whose Christian faith informs all that they do. People who do very clearly think for themselves. It annoys me immensely when people say we only follow Jesus because we're too stupid to think of anything else. What Paul is saying here is actually we should think about what we believe. We should be wary of accepting uncritically any other ways, especially when they might be presented by people who seem outwardly very clever or very pious. As we shall see when we move on, one of the groups in his sights here is the what's known as the Hellenistic Jews, Jewish people who are mixing up their insistence on ritual and legalism with a kind of mishmash of Greek philosophy that they were through which they were trying to make their religion more attractive to the clever Greeks of the day. He's warning the Colossian Christians off these various attempts to create a new religion out of the basically human-centered ideas that have been handed down to them, the tradition he talks about here, and a lot of superstition about spiritual forces, what he calls the basic or elemental principles of the world, of the cosmos. And to counter that, he stresses once again the centrality of Jesus and this intriguing paradox that lies at the heart of all that we believe, that Jesus was fully God and therefore superior to all other powers and authorities and fully human, so able to empathize with our fragile and vulnerable human condition. In Jesus, fully God and fully man, humanity can be reconciled to God, restoring the relationship that the Creator originally intended to have with his creation. In Jesus, we're offered a new start, which Paul here likens to being buried and then raised to life again, renewed and restored as objects of God's love. To use the phrase that Jesus himself used when he was talking to Nicodemus in John chapter 3, John's Gospel chapter 3. It's a phrase that's been stretched about and loaded with all kinds of other meanings now, but Jesus is like being born again, starting all over again. And for that new life to work properly, all the old stuff has to be got rid of, which is why Paul tells us here, God forgave us all our sins, all those wrong choices, those foolish decisions are forgiven. We're given a new start, a blank sheet, if you like. And so that we can continue to live this new life, Jesus releases us from the influence of evil. We now have a choice. We don't have to go that way. We can follow the way of Jesus and with the help of his Spirit, live as he directs us. You see, says Paul, Jesus overcame evil on the cross, that cataclysmic cosmic battle that was fought out in his body as he hung there dying, taking into his own being all the conflict that was going on. And it stripped evil of its power to affect us. We know that ultimately it can have no power over us. Our eternal future with God is assured if we're prepared to commit to him. Yet evil's still around. A quick glance at the television news or the front page of a newspaper will make that pretty obvious. Inequality, violence, racial injustice, greed, selfishness, in its many and varied forms, they're all still around. But they're now powerless to affect our relationship with God. And eventually they will be destroyed altogether. Jesus defeated them. He made, as Paul says here, a public spectacle of them, like a triumphant general leading his defeated opponents in procession through the empire. And they know it. They're just thrashing around now, trying to do as much damage as possible before they're finally annihilated. And Jesus promises us that we can look forward to a bright, eternal, evil-free future with him if we're prepared to take him seriously. And taking Jesus seriously is what Paul is all about. It's what this letter's all about. Don't get sucked into other ways of thinking, Paul says. Think about what you believe and check out that it's consonant with Jesus and his ways. Like millions of other people down through the centuries, I'm a Christian because I thought it through and I continue to do so. And it works. And what's more, I can now accept the forgiveness is offered through Jesus and allow him to lead me forward. Don't be deceived by big words and intellectual double talk. Keep your eyes on Jesus and allow him to lead you on to get the very best out of life here and now and to have that sure and certain hope of an eternal future with him in God's renewed and restored kingdom. Now, Paul unpacks all that a bit further in the next little section, which we'll consider next time. So tune in next week to see how that goes. Or if you do want to think a little more about this and explore it further, we can't really do it all justice in a few minutes on a Sunday morning or whenever you're watching this. If you want to explore a bit further, you could join our online Alpha course. There'll be details about that on the screen at the end of the service. But please don't stop thinking about it. And as Paul says, continue to live your lives in him, rooted and built up in him, strengthened in the faith as you were taught, and overflowing with thankfulness. But now, before we sing a final hymn, we're going to pause for a moment to pray, to bring before God the needs of ourselves, of our community, and our world. So let's pray. God of all places, all people, all time. We come to you today with our thanks for your Son, Jesus Christ, our Saviour and Lord. We thank you for his life and his example, his death and resurrection, his teaching and his inspiration. As we do our best to try and follow him, we pray for the help of your Holy Spirit as we live and work, rest and play day by day. We pray for our city at this time of pandemic, for doctors, nurses, paramedics, and all health and social care workers, particularly remembering today the partners and staff at the Westgate, Darwin, and Langton practices. We pray for local businesses and shops and all who work in them, for those who serve us in our local councils, both elected and employed, including our town clerk, Tony Briggs, and his staff at the City Council, and Diane Tilley and all who work with her at the District Council, and the difficult decisions they're having to make. We pray for the food bank, community groups, and neighbourhoods care schemes, and for all citizens, that together we might be aware of your help and your strength. We pray for those we know who have been bereaved, for those who are themselves unwell at home or in hospital, for those struggling with issues of mental health, unexpected poverty, isolation, and loneliness. May they all know your love, expressed through the help and support of friends and neighbours. And we pray for the wider world, for every country affected by this virus, for world leaders and those with influence and power, that they might make wise and equitable decisions. We pray for Myanmar, for Russia, for the new administration in the United States, and regions where there is extreme poverty, for violence and tension, unpredictable climatic change, and uncertainty about the future. Help those of us who have much to share with those who have little. You are the God who has shown your power at the cross and in the empty grave. Make yourself known in our world and reach out to help all those in need, we pray. We offer you our prayers in Jesus' name. Amen. A final song now as Colin, Annabelle and Sophia lead us in one of Stuart Townend and Keith Getty's hymns. St. Paul wrote about being overflowing with thankfulness, and these words express something of that and of the response that we can offer to God. I give my life, my all, to love and follow him. So join in with the words on the screen if you'd like to as we sing, My Heart is Filled with Thankfulness. Thank you once again, Colin and Sophia and Annabelle, for leading us in that song and for all your input into this morning's worship. And thanks, as always, to James and Colin and Steve of Jacob Productions, who have filmed and edited this morning's service. Thank you to those who've joined us from the local council, to our mayor for reading for us this morning, along with Primrose and Theo. Please keep sending in your photos and videos and messages for inclusion in the services, and let us know of any celebrations that are coming up. Many of the regular activities of the church, most of them online now, that's the house groups, the prayer groups, activities for young people and children and so on, they're still going on. You can find details of those on our church website or by using the contact details on the screen at the end of the service. If you'd like to get involved in walking around the city as you exercise, and in doing so, spotting the homes of other people from the church, don't forget to look out for the church logos in people's windows. There's details on the Wade Street Church social Facebook page. Churches together in Lichfield have their forum this week via Zoom. It's on Tuesday, the 9th of February. It's at 7:30. And it's going to include a presentation from Burntwood Be a Friend about supporting the community as Christians. And there are joining details for the Zoom on our church news sheet via the website. And if you're a church member, please note there's a church meeting via Zoom this Thursday. That's the 11th of February at 7:45. But now, some final words of prayer. Now may the peace of the Lord go with you. wherever he may send you. May he guide you through the wilderness, protect you through the storm.